And we are live. Hi everybody, it's your girl Minister Jazz, and with me today I have Morgan Pekma, and we are going to be talking about Constitutional Convention. It is the hot topic in New York right now because in a few months, less than 100 days, the big vote will happen, and we are urging you to vote yes for a Constitutional Convention. And Morgan and I are going to talk more about why we believe yes is the right vote. So Morgan, tell us a little bit how you got involved with the Constitutional Convention.
Well, I have worked in New York politics in many different capacities as a journalist, as an activist, as a good government, head of a watchdog organization for over a decade. And I've been very passionate about finding solutions to problems of our state government. I've tried it in all the conventional ways. I've tried it as a campaign manager. I've tried it as a journalist. I've tried it as a columnist.
Yes.
And all those ways have failed.
Yeah, it's like you hit like a envelope, like, now what?
Basically, the system is set up to block you from making substantive change. And the only way to smash those barriers to real reform is the Constitutional Convention.
Wow.
And so for a long time, because it comes every 20 years,
yes.
I saw it coming out, it's 4 years in advance, 3 years in advance, and as we got closer to it, I really wanted to be in the thick of this fight for real reform, and that's to get a yes vote on the Constitutional Convention.
Yeah, so 4 years, 3 years, now we're only like 90-something days.
Yes.
Until November 7th. 90-something days until November 7th. But what are some of the barriers and obstacles that you feel that we're facing with getting a yes vote?
So we have a system that conspires to disempower the people.
Mm-hmm.
It's controlled by party insiders and special interests who work really exclusively for their self-interest. Now, they're really clever in working for their self-interest because they couch it in terms of optimism, they couch it in terms of reform. They say everything that we believe in our hearts, but what's so despicable about it is that they use our rhetoric to disempower us.
Can you give us a real-life example of something that you can say that we can relate to and be like, oh, that's an example? Because it seems like you said, it's a disillusion. So we think that things are happening, but so I need an example. What's something that we might recognize?
So, anybody who's followed New York State government, New York City government, knows that rarely a month passes where one of our elected officials isn't hauled off in handcuffs, right?
All the time.
And that system is really been maintained by the party bosses, by the powers that be in Democratic politics and Republican politics, working together. So we have a 98% re-election rate for elected officials, right? So you can't lose.
I mean, that's a crazy number, 98% re-election rate?
So you don't have to worry that there are going to be any ramifications.
It's like you got your job.
Right. And not only that, even if you didn't have the high name recognition, it's the levers of power are there to preserve you.
Right.
And that means that while we say, oh, we have term limits, we have elections, right? Or you can vote the bums out. In point of fact, we really can't, because in most elections, we don't even have a choice. There's no one else is even on the ballot. Right? Just in this last petitioning process, which is how you get on the ballot,
right.
Again, the party bosses conspired to knock off a lot of citizens who just wanted to throw their hat into the ring to have an opportunity to run. This is one of the main things that we want to change in the Constitution. We want to make sure that the rules aren't rigged to help the party bosses, the insiders, maintain their iron grip on power.
Right.
And that will never be changed by any other mechanism.
Why would they change it if it's working for them?
Exactly.
Right?
So people might hear about gerrymandering, which is when politicians can basically decide who are going to be the voters to vote for them instead of who that we get to decide who's going to be our elected official.
Right.
I don't call them elected officials, I call them selected officials. Because most of the time, they are handpicked by the party bosses just because these are people who will do their bidding, right? And then, we don't have public financing of elections in New York State. We do in New York City. Why is that? Because that enables grassroots candidates to have the money to run independent campaigns. Oh my God, that's so threatening,
right?
And, you know, and we don't have term limits. Now, like, theoretically, term limits are not such a great idea because you should be able to elect whoever is the best person for the office. Yeah, that's true, but in point of fact, we have a system where once somebody gets in and they usually ooze their way into office through a back door,
yep.
Now you can never get rid of them. So you have mediocrity perpetuated for decade after decade after decade.
Tell me, I've heard about people like literally waiting for the seat. And so then, now that they're in, they feel secure, but they literally will wait and cater to the person. So it's almost like, even though we think that we're electing someone, that person is, like you said, selected. They already know that this is gonna be the predecessor. So almost like how the queen back in the day would appoint people. It feels kind of that way.
That is so right, Jazz. A lot of times our elected officials are sons or daughters or relatives of their predecessor,
yeah.
Or they're the chief of staff to the longtime member that they work for. And so there's never been an open election for these seats. They're just turned over again and again to the same folks.
And without an open election, it's just the same things, the same ideals, the same patterns will continue to perpetuate because there aren't new people with new ideas coming in.
Well, not only that, there's no accountability. That means that if you want to, you feel like you can like rip off your constituents,
right.
You feel that you can trade your political power for your own benefit and the benefit of people around you because you know that there's no repercussions for you. Then you also have everybody else becomes complicit in the system.
Right.
So if you're a big donor, and that means if you work for big pharma or big ag, or if you're a labor leader, labor unions are among the biggest donors to politicians in the state, or you're just a wealthy person, your interest is for people to stay in office because you invested in them, right? You put your money into controlling those people. You don't want to have high turnover and to have to exert your influence. And then those people, there might be a wild card person who says, you know what, I reject all you people. I'm going my own way.
The fair thing.
Man, that's everybody's worst nightmare. That's the fear of the leadership, because then there's a person that they can't control, the leadership of our legislators.
Yeah.
That's the fear of our parties, because they want to control the system. And that's the fear of our special interest groups. And I just want to get back to something that you said. What is the example, right? So the no coalition that's pushing against our positive yes message is called, they've called themselves New Yorkers Against Corruption. Now, there could not be, if you work in politics for a long time, you learn that people say up when they mean down.
Right.
They say pessimism, they say optimism when they mean pessimism. So New Yorkers Against Corruption is a coalition of organizations that is in place to maintain the status quo. The status quo is riddled with corruption and dysfunction. It could not be a more opposite message than what they call themselves.
Right.
But because most people are concerned with their families, they're concerned with their friends, they're concerned with just making a living.
And their pensions,
we can't follow politics so closely, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we hear New Yorkers Against Corruption and we're like, you know, Joe voters like, well, they're against corruption, right? Even though it is the antithesis of what they're trying to accomplish, which is to preserve status quo. And I'm not saying these people are corrupt, but what they're doing is they're keeping a corrupt system in place.
Yeah.
And you know, the other thing is that you always hear politicians say, I work for the people, right? I empower the people.
Yeah, that's what they always say.
We have an opportunity to have a people's convention where the people will be in charge of our government. And now what do they say? Hold on. You can't trust the people. You know, the people, they don't know what they're doing. Like, these are naive children. That you give them the keys, they're going to crash the car immediately, right?
Wow.
So this is what I mean about the complete disconnect between rhetoric and all the BS that were being sold by politicians. And then when the rubber hits the road, how their whole argument breaks down because it's based upon lies and disinformation.
Well, what I've noticed with the campaign is that it's really using people's emotions against them. It's telling people that their livelihood will be destroyed, knowing that they don't have the time to do the research and to hear things, and understanding that if they did take time to be a part of a people's convention, their very livelihood could be restored. And it's really disheartening that they're, you know, I almost say, well, why are you lying to us? You know, what would you say? Why? What do they benefit? Besides preserving the status quo, that's enough. But what are they really benefiting from lying to the people?
What's so sad about our politics, and what people who work in politics understand, is that fear is a more powerful motivator than love. This is perpetrated by the worst people in our politics because they know it works, right? Fear is a very easy message to convey because we're all fearful.
Yeah.
And particularly at a time when we're so beleaguered as a state, when so many of us are struggling to take care of our families, yeah, take care of our lives, when there's so much uncertainty ahead of us, and we are such easy victims and we're so easily manipulated by fear, right? Telling people about a positive message, telling people about the possibilities of change, about that we could band together as people and we could make a government that we hope to see. Well, we've been poisoned by generations of politicians
saying those words and not producing the results.
Exactly. Yeah. And so that we feel like when someone says that, it's inherently a lie,
yeah,
right? So even though we are coming from such a good and sincere place here,
yeah,
and like we don't represent any special interest groups, right? And this is, again, we're up is down, right? So our opponents are trying to paint us as special interest group. I work for a good government group, right? I have no interest in the outcome of this vote other than the fact that I am born and raised in New York.
Yeah.
My daughter is born and raised in New York. I have spent my career fighting corruption and to get good government in New York. I will not see a penny from the outcome of this election.
And I'll say this, for me, when I heard about the convention, I felt like this was an opportunity for people, black and brown, to participate in their government and doing something to make changes in regards to criminal justice reform and, you know, voters' rights and all of the things that have been traditionally suppressive, you know, in the system. It's just like, this is an amazing opportunity to make those changes. So, you know, that's why, you know, I wouldn't have known you. You know what I'm saying? We're not like, you know, in cahoots against a greater system. It's just like people interest. What makes me a person as a, you know, what makes me a person, a mother, a sister, a friend, what I would want to see come out of a convention is what drives the interest there.
And you know what is so sad about Jazz? And this is kind of a politically incorrect thing, and so it's not said oftentimes,
yeah,
is that black and brown neighborhoods oftentimes have the worst representation. And you'll see so many elected officials go to prison. And what you'll see is when you have selected officials in affluent neighborhoods, well, they have power because of all the forces of money in their community that give them an outsized voice. If you are in a poor neighborhood, if you're in a neighborhood and you need services, and you have a bad elected official, you are all the more powerless for being, and you're already disempowered, right? So when you talk about black and brown neighborhoods, when you talk about neighborhoods, low-income neighborhoods, like, those are the neighborhoods that need a people's convention more than any group, right? You know, we've talked about throughout our campaign how the Constitution was largely written in 1894 with one woman delegate and zero people of color.
Zero.
And the only time it's been substantively changed was in 1938 when there were five women and two people of color.
Right.
These are the voices that have written our Constitution.
And
right?
When you think about the statistics of New York right now, it's 61% women. You know what I mean? So it's like, how do we make that, when you start talking about the People's Convention, how the question becomes, how do we make that room be reflective, a true reflection of New York and all of its diversity.
Right. And when you talk about, you know, the Bronx, and although the Bronx has been growing and changing in a lot of wonderful ways,
really great.
You know, the Bronx has among the lowest voter participation in the
5%
state.
5% in the last election.
You know, the Bronx is not punching its weight.
Yeah.
Right? If the Bronx turned out with the same type of percentage vote that affluent neighborhoods in Manhattan do, affluent neighborhoods in Brooklyn do, then the Bronx would get so many more services. It would be, its voice would be heard so much louder and clearer.
Yeah.
in Southeast Queens, in Buffalo and Rochester. These are places that deserve to have a voice that at very least is in proportion to their population and their importance in the state, and they are not having that voice now. The system doesn't want these areas to have a voice because those are our wild card voices, right? They're not votes that have been already put in one column, right?
Yeah, conditioned.
And that's scary to everybody who's in power.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to what gets to happen over the next 90 days. I believe, you can call me whatever, but I do believe in people. I believe in the power of people. I've seen what magical things, if you will, when people get together and stand together, can make happen. And so I vote yes for a People's Convention. And I'm hoping that all of our viewers know and vote yes as well. Please, if you have not already, RSVP. We are having an event in the Bronx. You can find the link right on our page where we will be giving more information on how you can become a delegate and in a People's Convention. So stay tuned. We'll be with you again next Tuesday. I want to say thank you so much, Morgan, for joining me today.
It's so easy to say yes.
It feels so much better to say yes.
Right.
So yes to a People's Convention, yes to change, yes New York. Bye-bye.